Today we talk about NetScaler Troubleshoot Deep Dive. So it's more of a feedback regarding the implementation in large customers on how to resolve some issues that was appear on each customers, which tool I have used to try to resolve the issue. And I finished with also some kind of things regarding training, where some stuff that maybe you know, or maybe some of you don't know, on the NetScaler products. Just to this a little bit of me, so I'm owner of my own company from 8 years. I'm working on Citrix for 20 years. Right now, on production, on pre-sales, on design, a lot of stuff. So I was involved in a very large customers and a lot of seats. And this year was my 11th year at UBC. I started in Lisbon in 2000.
So you're a centurion now.
Maybe. On a synergy 10 years ago. French expert also 15 years ago. So right now it's virtual UBC.
Yeah, it used to be a platform. For those of you who are for those of you who are new to the event, it used to be called PopForm, and people would always write me and say, my manager says, what's PopForm?
But is it the pub or PopForm?
Yeah, exactly.
That is the problem. So there are chunks then. So what is covered right now on the session? I will cover only two versions in MPX box, not SDX, not VPX, because it's a very large environments, different environments as well. So I will focus only on that box. I focus also on ICR proxy features, because NetScaler, NetScaler, there is a lot of features, there is load balancing, there is firewalls, there is a lot of stuff. So we can cover in conversation everything. That's okay. And focus on web production use case, focus network analysis. And what is not covered today, it's a solution on another box that I built, but I have already said that. There is no demo. If you want demos, there is no demo. Because for me, it's complicated to provide demos, but maybe I can just explain one thing regarding the NetScaler and do a little demo. And as well, all other case that I have not covered. So for me, when you have an issue, an incident, and large companies, you need to have a methodology. So if you don't have a methodology, you need to think about that. Because you have an issue, you need to fix that maybe less than 4 hours. Because a lot of people is working, maybe for partners are very far away. Maybe in India, maybe in China, maybe any place on the world. And behind NetScaler, there is a lot of people working. So it's a lot of money if you can't work properly on their VDIs, because it is maybe developers, maybe it's guys that is paid by day, maybe $2,000 by day, because it is a very specialist, maybe when working in CATIA or AutoCAD or things like that. So they need something that works properly. So for me, there is four things to know. The first one is tactical, second one is technical, first one is testing, and last one is training. So I will explain for each point my vision regarding how to get in charge an issue on the NetScaler with this widget. So tactical, it's humans. So the most important problems with when you need to troubleshoot NetScaler, maybe other stuff, NetScaler, so you can see very quickly what's happening regarding humans. So you need to choose the good humans and the good teams to involve the team to resolve the issue. If you don't choose the great guys, you fail. It's not maybe the guys that have the most competencies. is maybe the guy that is most fair and cheap with other teams, because you need to work together to fix the issue. So if you say this competition is not great, so you need to choose the good guys that want to resolve the issue as soon as possible.
So Webster, you're out.
So I have just put some things, so assign system guys on network guys. So PropelGuard was not there, so I put Playmobil, because Playmobil is maybe more like humans. And the others is very...
It's a copy of Lego.
Yeah, it's a copy of Lego.
No one here?
Just us.
Okay, I'll go.
You're way from below.
Pizza.
So, what I mean regarding us humans, I have two system guys in network guys, but maybe it's a system team on networking. And basically, with Netscaler, it's the CTX team on the network guys. So. But you need to assign one guy that it is in charge to do the communication with those other guys on the teams. Because on network, you have maybe one team, the guy in charge of the one, otherwise it's charged on the proxies, otherwise it's charged in firewalls, so you can talk with all of them at the same time. So you need to put one guy that you can talk with them. Otherwise you take a long time and you can fix in less than 4 hours. It's just impossible. Another point that is important, we need to check the guys passing on the issue. Which level is the guy? It's level 1, level 2, level 3, which guy you are talking with them. Because sometimes you are for Citrix, if I take the example of Citrix, when you call the support guys, the first one is the level 1, the second one is level 2. And it's a very critical and firing everywhere, there is a level 3. But in fact, some customers, you need for some issue, the level 2 directly. You don't need to pass all of that, because you have already validated by Citrix. They know the guys are what's there, they know that competencies are what's there, so they need the guy directly on L2, not L1. Another thing, it's management on set guys. On some cases, I have involved on this issue, there is management guys on set guys. So on the conf call, you have technical management and sales. So you need to take care about that. If there is a technical problem, a technical issue, then you need to put on the conf call only the technical guys and do another conf call for the management, because the management wants also a feedback, what's happening, etc., every hours or maybe every half an hour, but not involve the management guys with the technical guys. you lose a lot of time. And you need to explain to the management that don't care about LPX or about netting. So another point is, does this issue affect a new implementation or a new project? So if it is a new implementation, new project, the level is not the same. Because you can put a lot of guys like that on the, if it is a new implementation or a new project, the Citrix support don't ask new an entry. It would be very difficult because
I have a question. I'm really curious because a lot of institutions in this era now are dividing up responsibilities. For example, we're going through our own internal restructuring where there's a plan to divide people up into, you know, according to the DevOps model. Yes. So basically an engineering side and an operation maintenance side. How does that fit into this model in terms of where the different people sit? Do you have everyone still integrated in one uniformed force? And if you do have it divided up, how then do you figure out which person in what area and which person in another area are all to be, you know, I mean, how do you make the choice which individuals all get pulled into this support model?
So, normally, in some cases I was involved in some issue. So the manager of my team know the other manager of the other team. So then they talk together to find the good people. Because if you are a contractor, if you just arrive maybe 1 week before and you have the issue, you don't know all the stuff, all the guys, because it's a very large company. Mm-hmm. If you have arrived just 1 week before, you need to explain that to your manager, and your manager needs to give you a good guide. But you can't know everyone. So.
Right, and part of the difficulty, I think, is if you have multiple people involved in management, you've got to get them talking on the right level so that the key component individuals don't get somehow left out in that process.
Yeah. And you took a lot of time to explain to the management, or as well as the management, that if they networking on the system guys, the system guys was pushing, it's a network, and the network is pushing, oh no, it's a system. Mm-hmm. And you need to work each of them to demonstrate that it's not a system, it's not a network. Yep.
So one of the things that we ended up doing as part of a post-mortem after every time there was an issue is reevaluating the personnel we had assigned, because we discovered in some cases maybe your best guy at one thing is not your best guy when the house is on fire. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So your second or third best NetScaler guy may be your best NetScaler guy when everything is broken. And we ended up doing quite a bit of shutdown. So part of any of our post-mortem stuff now is, how did people handle things, and do we need to reassign? Was that just a bad day, or you know, somebody's spouse pregnant or something like that? Or do we really need to fundamentally change the composition of the team?
How big was your team?
So my team itself is about 7 people, but in any sort of situation like this, there's probably at least 3 to 4 other teams pulled in, so the bodies on the conference call, usually in excess of 30.
And those 7 would know NetScaler?
No.
Because that would be like a global collection.
Well, let's be real, if it were NetScaler,
it's probably
I'm not very good. So, but if you're talking like, if you proxy this out to other things, like whether it be Zen Desktop, Zen App,
and your normal disaster conference call has 30 people on it, one person doing the work, and 12 people going, is it done yet?
I'll make one correction for that. You got 30 people on it, and you got 30 people all pointing the finger at 30 other people. Mm-hmm. So nobody's doing any work.
How about this, guys? Suggestion, right? So outfit everybody with Fitbits or with Apple Watches, and then feed this thing to OctoBlue, making sure you get what the right person. And start monitoring spouses as well. Thank you.
Just to be sure.
There's no fucking way you're monitoring my spouse, Alex.
That would be community effort.
Boom! Nice, liking your work, sir.
We are not on the source of your wife.
So let's go ahead. So yes, it's important as sales guy involvement on this implementation process. The sales guy, in the case of IFC, the sales guy sell to the customer more than will. There is an issue, and they sell more than will. There is a 20 megabit on the line, on the link, from on the one. On the sales guy, they say, no, it's not enough. So they pay for 50 megabytes. And they don't resolve any issue, but they pay more. But it's great for the sales guy. So you need to check if the sales guy is involved on the control. And so it's very important. And so applies the methodology. So this, I think, a lot of you know this this picture. For me, it's important to know that when you have an issue, you need to first start with the different levels. So if you start with the application earlier, before, at the first time, maybe you can have not checked the other things. So it's important to check before the level 1, level 2, level 3, and do like that. Not do by the behind, on the top. So use first network teams near to physical layer. The same, the approach is normally on the data centers, you have some guy that is in charge to put the cables, do some captures with probes, do something like that. So you need to involve first these guys to check if there is some issues on the physical layer, on the cables, and things like that. Because I have an issue on my customer, the cable was correctly implemented on the box, but after some months, it's not working. So we need to change the cable. And we have taken weeks and weeks to find that it is a cable. So we have go on software and check everything, change the duplex and things like that, and finally it was a cable. That's crazy.
They didn't have any money left after they bought the scalers.
Yeah. And near the port or implement the port, so if you can implement a port on near the port and take the traffic to know exactly what it is on the cable. Involve EGOT teams only if nothing was found on the first layers. So it's the same. When the management has an issue like that, they say, put everything on the staff, on the conf call. No, there is no sense. So you can't talk with 20 people to fix an issue on less than 4 hours. It's not impossible. So you need to choose the good people to do the job. So check physically the appliance and network cables with your eyes. Yeah. Right now, most of the huge companies, you don't have any access on the data centers. You don't have any access on the box. You don't see if before when I have stuck working, you can go to the data center to see the LEDs, what is not working, the hard disk, you can see the LED. Right now, you can't see anything. So you need to involve some guys that is on this data center with you, and to check everything is working.
Oh, you can also use the ILO board.
You know, to that point, I've actually seen people who needed an Ethernet cable, and they went and they thought, nobody's using this one. Oops. They pulled it off of a machine and literally plugged it into something else. And so the only way to ascertain that things were really broken were indeed to go into the machine room and, you know, to the horror of the person who discovered it, to see that somebody had actually removed the cable.
It must be some wacky place which use like Zensor and stuff, isn't it?
Of course.
Another point regarding the issues with Netscaler, you need to assign analyst guy to decrypt the captures. Because if you have a guy of Citrix that take a watch lock, and they take a capture, and they analyze the capture, and another guy on network teams that do a watch lock, analyze the capture, there will be a problem. Because if they don't capture with the same parameters, they don't have the same capture, and it's better to have one guy that is involved on that, and that use the better knowledge on that, and that can read the capture properly, and expose what was on the capture correctly. Because a lot of guys, yes, I know Wireshark now, don't know Wireshark. Wireshark, it's a specific job, it's not a... So you need to know some features regarding Wireshark to work with them. Another point, it's validate create a schema with the network teams. Because many times you have many access chains, so an access chain to maybe Bangalore, another access chain to Romania, another to New York City, and there is no schema. And finally, it's partners. It's not on the company. And the partners, they are their own network, own one. So you need to have a schema regarding the point to point. So it's very difficult to have a schema.
finally, when you have an issue, you don't have any schema. So you don't know yet where the flow is coming, where is the inbound and the outbound. Yeah.
So what is your methodology for keeping it up to date and also keeping assured that the proper people who need to access it can access it, your schemas?
So the only way is to do the schemas. You need to do a team working with the network guys and the system guys to check if the network guys have the already schemas or not. Maybe it's the system guys that have the schema, and you need to work to the team to perform a new schema. But because maybe it's not up to date. It's true. Maybe it's the old one.
But do you have a wiki or some means of assuring that things really do get updated, or some way of tracking who made changes to it and that it is accurate?
No. The problem is there is no up to date. Because sometimes, if I take an example, you have implemented active link, and maybe there is an issue. So the guys go to the other link, but you need to update the schema.
Mm-hmm.
You have done a change, you need to update the schema. The same if you change the routers, if you change something on the access chain, you need to update the schema, but it's not done. Because normally on the change, when you do a change, you need to put each step on. After that, update produce procedures, mm-hmm. update schema. And many people do that because it takes a lot of time and a lot of money. Yeah, this is the reality.
Yeah, and then of course people try and do something, and what they have to go by is not accurate.
Yeah.
It is a problem.
Yeah, but it's a
huge problem.
Yeah, it's a problem. So the technical case, I switch right now to the technical case that I have signed in production on large companies. The first one is a loop scenario. So the guys have put two cables on the box without any VM, any LACP, on any aggregation. So what is happened, it's a loop scenario. So it's explained there. So they normally on the Netscaler, when you put the cables, all the interfaces are talking with the switch. So you need to separate the flow for each network interface. Or otherwise, you need to implement VLANs. In this case, the guy have implemented that. I have asked me, but why you don't have good VLANs? Why don't you do LACP? There is change is too complex. Implemented change is too complex. Okay, but right now there is an issue. And the problem is when issue like that is you have the you can find after that the how to check the CPU. So configure, so the way to implement properly the cable, so configure failover interface, implement LACP, async VLANs. Otherwise, the last solution is put only one cable. The problem is, if you don't do that, when you need to give to the support guys of Citrix all the stuff, all the information, it's right there. So the super guys of Citrix, what is this implementation gap? Fix this issue first the issue regarding looping. After that, we can help you. So by design, you need to also implement the good foundation on MPs, on all those other stuff. You need to implement the good foundation. If you don't implement the good foundation, you maybe have a problem after. So this is a support, a collect support that I have done, and it is great thing that you need to fix. It's not critical, but it is an error. Unexpected restart.
So when you have a MPX box, you can normally you can buy an MPX box, but some MPX box is sold by design with only one power supply. Okay. So the customers don't want to buy one more power supply. Because maybe they have not even enough money, I don't know, but it's impossible for me. You buy an MPX, why don't add another power supply? Because the cost of the MPX is very huge. On the price, I don't understand. So on this case, the customer don't have agreement a second power supply. So what happened? So you can check that on the with the command stat system details. And also, as well, check the power supply with that system detail. So the first the step to fix that, you need to add the secondary power supply into the system. And with the power supply, you can see, with this command, you can see as well when the Netscaler works was the start, the last time it was the start. And you can see also the temperatures and everything with this command. On this box was not supported, but normally you see the two power supplies that was there. What I was talking about that, because on this customer, it is the DR site, and there is only one power supply on the cable. So it was removed. And the guy is working on the DR, and nothing more is working. Yeah, okay, it's good, it's the DR, but only one power supply. So, it can happen.
Yeah. That looks familiar.
So, it's happened, so. I have seen that on very large companies. So, very few cables, on very few that don't mix the cables and data cables. The FTP, FTC cables and data cables. But this happened. Our slowness. So measure of the issues that appear on the access chain for the end users is slowness. It's working one day before, and one day after, it's slow. What's happened? So the first thing to do when you have an issue like that, if you have a data center company with multi-data centers or multi-zones, you need to verify that if the latency is the same or not on each data center. So you just need to do a ping from each data center to find if there is an issue on the two data centers. If you don't do that, this is the first step to do. Because sometimes the flow was different from each data center. It is not the same link. So it depends on the access chain. Some change have the same links, some other one have different links, so depends on the access chain. In this case, there is more than 100 access chain. So it's very complex. Ping also between different agent nodes because you can ping directly from the primary Netscaler and the secondary, and you can check also as well if the secondary is working properly or the primary is working properly. The second thing you can do is switch the secondary to primary to check that it's working better or not, and it not cost a lot to do this on operation. Use a trusted path with PingPlotter. So PingPlotter is a nice tool that gives you all the trust. I present that. PingPlotter. Okay. So this is a capture that I take. And you can see that that was happening. So when you do the ping, there is something that is broken on the trust, so it's not normal. It's not normal, so here I use a ping plotter. It's a tool that allows you to see the trust on which host have some problem of retransmission or something like that. And this is a schema to explain you. For in my case, there is the data center with the customer. This is Romania, where is a partner that using Citrix. All the flow traffic for Citrix is on the inbound and the outbound is going from the customer to Romania, on other traffic from other side. So there is a nominal part and the data part. And all Citrix is the data part. So this is important to do a schema because on the mind of people, no, it's the flow go, no, depends. And when you have a slowness, you need to know exactly where the flow are going. So you need to took a little time with the network guys, maybe 1 hour, 2 hours to understand exactly. And after that, you could think about how to fix the issue, which thing you need to do, maybe to switch the primary to secondary, maybe on the one firewall, because you have two nodes, change one node to another one, etc. So the good, so if you can implement a probe, this is a probe that has put all the flow, and here you can see the retransmission. So retransmission, what that means? Retransmission just means that there is somewhere on the flow, on the network, there's congestion, so maybe one equipment, there is maybe a 100 CPU, or maybe the network card there is a problem on the network card, so you need to find which equipment is doing that. On my case, what's a firewall? And we take, on this case, three months, every time on conf call with the network guys to find that this firewall. And it is 3 months, why? Because the guys on firewall, they know that there is an issue because there is too many rules on this firewall and it is a plan to upgrade them. So they don't want to say to us that it is an issue, they want to wait to upgrade them and to fix the issue. So finally we'll find where it is an issue, but it takes a lot of time. So this is another example regarding that. You can see on Wireshark that it is a lot of retransmission. So you need to take a trace on Nextcloud, on client-side, on firewalls, or maybe other box. So to discover that, you need to do a trace on some parts of the access chain, and they took a little bit time. But sure, the first thing you need to do on your part, on system, on your Citrix stuff. And after that, you need to work to the network. So in this case, what you can see on the Wireshark, there is too many retransmission, so it is not normal. Another point is when you have an issue like that, you need to try to reproduce the issue. Because the guy is calling, maybe another partner is working fine, so you say, my box and MPX is okay. Because on the same box, there is many partners that's coming. My box is okay, it's no problem. But for the partner, this partner is not working properly. So you need to try to reproduce directly on the data center what is happening. But I've used
it's your laptop.
It's never Alex's fault. No. It's a chocolate.
So I use the tools of thing?
No.
It's
shared with this.
And you can use the tool directly on the client device?
Yeah.
And you can use directly the tool and put on your client device. Just
it's a very... It's a download link.
It's very easy to use. You don't need to implement an appliance or things like that. It's working. It's working properly. So another point is I have used also HIT. So with HIT, if you have HIT, so if you have HIT, you can use the HIT as well.
Yeah, cold flash is there, Alex?
Only if you have right now, if you have a lot of money, you can use Insight or Mass. Because right now Mass, you need to pay a little bit if you have more than 30 receivers. So before we have Insight speed, but right now, it's not tricky.
But why use Mass if we now have the control ops though?
Yeah. Let's apply some of your techniques to troubleshoot the problem. Sorry.
Well, now you can see the controls from the script response.
Another point is regarding the TCP profile. I have seen again another customer that have implemented some Mescal Gateway on the sandbox. And they don't have implement the default pizza in the profile that was already there on 10.1 of Citrix.xlmp. Why? Because they have implemented the first one when with the GUI, the wizard. Okay, so they implement the good parameters. But if you create manually a server on the Mescal Gateway, there is no profile, no optimization, nothing.
Something that we're actually good for.
So I have just put the link for getting that, but it was in the internet many times. This is also some parameters that you need to implement properly with the Netto guys, because we have some question regarding that if there is an issue. Maybe they ask you what maximum packet per MSS, things like that. So if you are not a network guy, you don't know this typical parameters. So it's better to work with the network tool and implement with them the good parameters. Because if you have an issue, you have worked together and it's better. So this is one last issue that we have find. It is a customer that want to implement authentication with LDAP, RSA, smart card on the same server. So on the same server, then implement all of that. But finally, we have find some issues getting that.
Let me check, there is nothing wrong.
So the case one, because your customer don't issue clear certificate with the same certificate authority for any application. The other customer, when you put the smart card on the client device, so there is a certificate to go to the personal user personal store, but in fact on the customers they also provide some certificate on this part. And when you use that, the problem is when there is a connection on the server on the Mescal Gateway, they will look about all the certificates what's there. So when you connect, it grabs the information and go on send them to the Mescal. And you can grab there very simple expression. You can put some expression advanced. So you just you can't use maybe contains public certificate authority root or something like that. But you can go advanced and put some features that was in the on the certificate. So the case two is your customer don't know what certificate was installed on each personal user store or no certificate on the computer personal store. So in this case, you need to implement advanced expression on end factor. What that mean? If you implement advanced expression on end factor, you need to be on the enterprise license. So you need to add more money on your index. So on my case, on this customer, they have already bought the enterprise licenses for some part, but for other part, it's standard. So they need to add more money. And they are in this situation for one part. The case three is you don't know what certificate was installed in each personal user store and don't know if certificate are present on computer personal store. Because the brain is, when you have a certificate on a computer, on the computer, on the personal store, there is a certificate if you have only one Accelerator gateway configured, the rest of it named, not the portal or something like that. When there is a published application, you click on them, the rest of it named will check if there is a certificate, and they use them to do the password authentication. And it's not working because it's a computer certificate. So the goal to resolve this issue, you need, finally, you need n factor, advanced expression, and optimal gateway. Optimal gateway, I don't know if you know the how it works. So in fact, you have one receiver for the authentication, and it is only for the authentication. And after that, you have an SSH proxy receiver that do only the SSH proxy. And you can send the whole traffic on the SSL proxy when the user authenticates on the first Netscaler gateway for authentication. And in this case, you can remove on the SSL gateway all the mandatory certificate. The option mandatory certificate, you can remove them. And in this case, you can fix the this issue. But it's very complex on this. You need to spend a little more money.
Cha-ching!
Testing. So this is the last. So what's your test plan? It's just a little important thing. Because the problem is Netscaler, but other vendors are the same. They change the firmware maybe every 3 months, every 6 months, every 1 year, but when you do a new change and you implement a new firmware, you need to know exactly how the users is try to their connection, on which device they are using, and all of that need to be explained on the test plan. If you don't do that, when you are implementing a new firmware, or if something is not working anymore, it will be a problem. It's sure that make time, but so another point: ask users to test and wait for the feedback. Some customers don't want to wait for the feedback. You have planned a change for this day of the month at this hour. The change need to be done, but you don't have received any feedback. So what you do? Because on this customer, we are waiting 6 months. 6 months to do the change, to plan the change. And there are no feedback. So does I need to wait for the feedback and do the change? And does I need to do the change? And don't wait for the feedback? This is the question.
Go and hunt them down and threaten them with bodily harm.
If you change, go to bar.
Another point is regarding the new firmwares. So check the technology. So on some technology, there is clearly describes the fixed issue and also the known issue. There's a lot of known issues.
But there should be another one, added issues.
Mystery.
Oh, yes.
Known issues and unknown issues.
Things we think we probably broke.
That one will be connected.
Things we really
can't. Well, Xenon Cell has it.
If you can validate as well your solution on Citrix Internet Service, so do a diagnostic and put on your on Citrix Inside before delivering the product to the customer. So it don't take a lot of time and give a lot many information. So
does anyone think that the Inside is actually useful?
No.
It's pretty minimal.
I mean, it's great to show the customer.
I
want to
say it's better than nothing.
Yeah.
Well,
mm-hmm. Great place for junior techs to start.
And I have caught a few things in there, but no.
Version that you need to update.
Yeah. Yes.
So yeah, but once you get any step advanced, it's like to. Yeah.
I've heard a few times through the grapevine that some truly awful setups have detected things, and if you have people who don't do this for a living or something, and they got roped in and they did it, and nobody's touched it in 5 years since then, or something like that. That's probably not most things.
That's the first thing I send customers when I have problems. I'm like, go do this, read the report, do everything it says in it. If you're solving problems, let me know. And usually that fixes a lot of low hanging fruit stuff.
Some of us are working with Citrix to make Inside services better.
I was going to say. As long as someone is.
Well, somebody's got to write a script or something.
We don't know who they are, so.
Yeah.
I think it is someone is the key word, right?
Yeah. One.
Is it a website you can break up to make sure you keep working on?
Command Center is sunset.
Yeah. I know. But right now, use Command Center en masse to track your events. Maybe give you some great reports, and maybe you can fix the issue before you deploy the issue to the customer. So training, go closely with the network links each time you can. Grab information on any analysis with Russia. Use Citrix reports, so I put inside Command Center mass right now. Provide information to network teams regarding your implementation. Because most of the time, the Citrix guys are implement Citrix NetScaler, but don't have informed the network guys that was implemented. So you need to work together on that. Otherwise, the network team never help you. So it's a team. Yeah.
So I just wanted to ask the room, is anyone aware of anyone who is documenting Wireshark stuff specifically with Citrix traffic and functionality? I mean, there's plenty of Wireshark stuff out there, but when I go look, there's almost nothing that's like a case or study or anything like that.
You probably have to work with it and understand it at some degree to know what the packet should look like. And
right, I'm just not aware of anybody who's publicly doing that stuff.
Buy an extra hop, they do it.
Any of you guys are really network geniuses?
Maybe Citrix had something that we need to talk to Citrix.
I've seen them, but they're pretty brief.
Okay. So training NetScaler process. So I have used the NetScaler process on my presentation. So maybe can help you when you have some issues. This is the most important process that is running on the box. So there is also file systems on the NetScaler, so hard drive on the with some directories, with some code dumps. Where is the code dumps? What is the flash drive? What is the certificate SSL? So you can copy the certificate or grab the certificate or do a backup. Where is user monitors, user motion, brand drive. So the sum of command, show command. So you can use this show command to collect information. There is more commands like that on ICI connection. This one is important. Why is it important? Someone here can explain me why this command is important.
You?
So it's important when you have the case on the customer side and there are multiple Netscaler gateway on the same box. So if you need to know how many guys is connecting on this Netscaler gateway on another one, you need to know the how many guys is connected on that. You need to use this command with putting also the source address on that, and you have the number. And after that, you can do a grab and grab the information, because the management need to have this information. How many guys is connecting on each server on the same box? Because by design, when you go to the Netscaler, you go to the GUI, there is the number connection is for all the boards. There is not possibility to have it's by design. We have asked to Citrix to modify that, but can't really do that. So the other stack commands that I use. NSCon command with K. So you need to use the uppercase J key, the low one. So they give you some information regarding the current log files, name of the servers on the stats, and things like that. This is an example. You can see the stata, the plot on the V. CPU. So interface. So this one is also useful. Because the ns.log, you have many ns.log that it's transformed to it's rotated. And with this one, you can collect information on all the ns.log.
Or you can just dump it on the Splunk and call it down.
I have used Splunk, and I was using Splunk as well. The problem with Splunk is not the Splunk build. The problem is when you need to do a design, and you need to do the you need to present the data. Because the management, they don't know which data they need. And you spend a lot of time to do the great presentation for the management. And if the guy, the management guy, change, you need to change the dashboard. This is the problem of Spring. On the ULK is the same. Depends on the company, but I have worked maybe 1 year with PLLK and Splunk and lost as that, and I was working as well with Splunk. So it's a good place, but the problem is regarding the dashboard, it's crazy. So I just list a little bit the tools that I use. So Ping, Trustwood, Qt, Wireshark, and Plotter and Team as well. So so the do's and don'ts. Implement your box with the network teams and validate L2, L3 stuff correctly first. Implement two power supplies. So for me, it's I imagine playing $20,000 on the box without only one power supply. It's crazy. Don't read other web because Netscaler is used by many people over the world. So a lot of some of guys that I've met that it's in charge of Netscaler, every time they say, oh, Netscaler is very complicated, you don't know it's specific stuff. So I have worked on L4 and L7 for many years. So I've started on 2006 or 2005 with another product. He was working on also.
Does anyone know how the company was called before Citrix bought them?
Net6.
Yeah. That was looking for it phone way.
Wasn't Net6 the CAN though?
That's the gateway.
That's the gateway.
Yeah.
Netscaler was always around since 1998.
Yeah, Netscaler has been the name, wasn't it? Before they bought them?
Netscaler?
I'm pretty sure it was.
No, Netscaler was the gateway. Yeah,
Net6 was the gateway of
ports. Yeah, but there was something before them though.
No, it wasn't.
I thought it was Netscaler.
It was Netscaler in 98. Then Taros was the app firewall. And then Net6 was the
yeah.
And don't implement this stuff if you can resolve the production issue. If you never have used a network production issue or something like that, don't do that alone. Use something that explain you the network, explain you how to resolve the issues. Maybe the guy will work with you during 10 days, but it's enough. you know, I think